Goldy, as we take a look at this crisis, the COVID-19 pandemic that has affected the world and affected Canada and its economy, what has it taught Canada about our vulnerabilities?
Well, look, I mean, when there's an unprecedented event like this, I think the reality is we're not just Canada that's learning, we're all learning. I think everybody around the world is kind of figuring out what do we do in a situation like this. And clearly in Canada, I think there's a number of things we can unpack. I mean, look, first of all, I think a lot of people woke up and thought, what do you mean we don't have access to, you know, personal protective equipment for our healthcare workers? That's a realization that I think struck many as somewhat of a surprise. But should it really? I mean, we are in a global environment. There's global supply chains. You know, there's a lot of talk about ventilators today. Even if we wanted to, there are 1,700 parts that go into a ventilator. So could we make them all ourselves? Maybe, but not anytime soon. So it's trying to find that balance between how did we get into a place where the reliance seems to be so much outside of the country, but on the other hand, wanting to be able to regain some control over some things that we consider essential. And I think on that front, we should applaud the efforts of many businesses around the country that, much like as in wartime, have pivoted and responded to manufacturing these goods. But it does raise a broader question, doesn't it? What about next time?
Right. And to your point, in terms of next time, maybe it won't be a health scare. Maybe, forgive me, it could be a cyber attack. It could be something else of some other magnitude. Canadians have been receiving help from the provincial government, from the federal government. You did mention companies that have been pivoting their manufacturing. On a go-forward basis, how can the private sector get more involved? How can they be more of a partner?
Yeah, and I think the key word there is partnership, being a partner, Larysa. I mean, the reality is we have too much schisms in this country. We have schisms between the federal government and the provinces. We have interprovincial trade barriers. We have, you know, historically been told that labor and business don't align and big business and small business doesn't align. I think all of that has to be thrown aside. We need to smarten up in a hurry. And this crisis is the moment in which we can reflect on two things. One is we've been pretty lucky to get to where we are. But that luck may have run out for all of us. And we need to think about the new world order, if you will. And that will require building resiliency, building capacity and capabilities. We need to be much more nimble. I mean, you look at this crisis here, the regulatory response, the financial response, the business response has been on Mach 10. Well, we should be thinking about how, maybe not Mach 10 all the time, but how do we make sure that we act much more diligently and rapidly in being competitive coming out of this cycle? Because one of the things we all know is there's going to be a lot of economic pain around the world here. Countries, as we've noted in your programs, noted many times, might be going down the protectionist route, but we can't afford that. As Canada, we need to be, we are who we are. We're a trading nation. We're a nation that requires investment. We're a nation that requires immigration. We're a nation that has tremendous demands on our infrastructure. I mean, I think one of the things we're all learning about here is the importance of technology, the need for 5G to be competitive. These are all things that we've been having the luxury of discussing and debating and being quintessentially Canadian about. This coming out of this situation, we can no longer afford to rest on the laurels of that luxury. We need to be responsive and in a rapid way. That, I think, is going to be a learning for all of us as Canadians, is how do we get more control of our destiny by being quicker in our response to these challenges?
Do we need a more strategic view when it comes to our energy sector?
Well, look, to me, this is an all-in moment. This is not about trying to find winners and losers and separating sectors. This is about saying, who are we? Who are we? Well, we're a trading nation. We're a natural resource nation, and we are a human resource nation. And we have the blessing and the curse of geography being next to the G1 and being in a part of a continent that is relatively secluded from what's being taken place in different parts of the world. How do we leverage our strengths? How do we leverage our shortcomings? These are conversations that I think we need to have. And energy is going to be a very critical part of that. Because while you know, some may see this as a moment to, like, let's just move on from fossil fuels, energy is not just about the lands. It's not just about oil and gas. It's about energy in all of its forms, from our nuclear capabilities in Canada, to our hydro capabilities, and to our renewables industry. There's a lot of opportunity here. And I think we need to have, yet again, a responsible, mature conversation about the role of energy in Canada and our ability to leverage it as a resource to grow the economic wealth and prosperity of our people and support our social programs, but also help those that are perhaps on antiquated forms of energy to get off that and to be more modernized in their use of energy. So I think that conversation that we were having just before this crisis broke, it will likely return at some point in time in the future, Larysa.
Goldy, you had mentioned earlier on in the conversation about companies in Canada that have pivoted in order to help out specifically when it comes to our medical supplies. I want to bring up the point when the U.S. president had attempted to suspend medical supplies coming into Canada. And we saw examples, I mean, the EU as well, we saw examples of export controls all around the world. Your thoughts on how we can build a more durable supply chain here in Canada?
Yeah, this is a very important question. My master's thesis was actually about policy making during times of crises. And let me tell you two of the things that were covered in there. One is, it's no time to make policies in a crisis because you're making policies for the exception as opposed to the rule. So I would caution against people over responding and overreacting to policy measures for the crises. Let it settle. Let's figure out where we are as we go forward here. Don't make it for the exception. Let's think about the rule. The second thing is, it's always dangerous to do this, but it's particularly dangerous to do this in a crisis, which is to predict things. And right now, as you're seeing and we're reading regularly, there's all kinds of predictions about all the changes that are going to take place in our lives. Maybe not. When the dust all settles and we're 2, 3, 4 years out of this, maybe cruising is not such a big deal 4 or 5 years from now, or we're traveling regularly. There's a sense of heightened anxiety at this time. And so to me, it's very responsible to acknowledge that. It's also responsible to know that we are dependent on supply chains. One of the things that we have seen in this crisis here is the frustrations that businesses have felt inside Canada with our interprovincial trade barriers and our regulations and the episodic responses to the crisis with emergency measures in some cases and on in others. Some are essential services, some are not. We saw that in the United States. We've seen that around the world. And I think one of the things we need to do here is provide leadership on that issue to say, what are the essential supply chains in a crisis that need to be secured so that we can all operate in, at least in North America, with a single set of rules, because NAFTA allows us to do that. So for a lot of people, this issue is a false choice, I think. It's not, do we diversify away from America? Do we go to Asia? Do we forget about Asia and come back to America? I think this is not either or, it is and. We need to figure out how to continue our trade relationships and supply chains in Asia, but recognize that the whole world seems to be relying on that supply chain. We can't all get our PPEs from China. So what can we do in our own hemisphere to strengthen the continent, which includes expanding into Latin America and South America? I think those are the kinds of conversations I could reasonably predict would come out of this type of a crisis that we should be looking at.
What does a recovery look like for Canada?
Yeah, that's a great question. And it's today's April 15th when we're speaking. It's an issue that we are seized with. We just heard the Prime Minister talk about how a one size fits all recovery is not possible in Canada. But we need to figure out, how do we do this consistently? How do we maintain confidence? And our view is that there is a need for a national coordination for a responsible restart of our economy. I want to make it clear, none of us in the business community are out there screaming, turn it back on tomorrow. We were the very ones to say, turn it off 3 or 4 weeks ago. And that was an important moment in the life of this crisis. Now what we're saying is, we need to really work together, provincial governments, federal governments, businesses, and labor, amongst other stakeholders, to say, what does a responsible restart look like? And let's be clear, it must be guided by our medical advice first and foremost. We have a health emergency. We need to really understand this virus. I'm no doctor, but I read a lot of things every day that make me more uncomfortable as to just how certain people are about how this virus is going to behave. I, for one, want to know, can you catch it twice? Because if you can catch it twice, that makes a restart pretty complicated, doesn't it? On the other hand, if you can't, then we really need to start looking at the hot spots and isolating and doing a lot of testing, a lot of tracking, and a lot of tracing. And guess what that's going to do? That's going to raise issues of other topics for your podcast, perhaps, around privacy issues. You know, we're going to need to know who's where. So there's a lot of fundamental public policy issues that are still going to emerge. I think it requires an honest conversation with Canadians to ensure confidence. We want to give people hope and a sense of confidence that when things return, we're going to be able to sustain it. Because let me tell you, I think the worst thing that can happen for us is a false start of the economy that leads to a second shutdown. That could be catastrophic psychologically and perhaps even financially and economically, and we can't afford that.